Welcome back. In the previous segment, we derived the basic dynamical equation of entropic dynamics in an integral form. What I would like to do in this much shorter segment of this class is I would like to rewrite that same equation in differential form because, well, typically that provides way more insight into what it is that's actually going on. So let's do that. So here we are. We have the basic equation of entropic dynamics written in integral form. We have a probability distribution that defines what we mean by an instant, and we can propagate it forward to the next instant. Remember, this is a transition probability for short steps, and we propagate it to get the next probability distribution. If you want to get the full dynamics, what you do is you repeat. Put this guy back in here and perform the same thing until you get rho of x double prime and then proceed. So now what we would like to be able to show now is that this equation is equivalent to an equation in differential form which takes this form of a continuity equation. What you have here is a divergence in configuration space. Recall the index x, the index a refers to a particle, a point in configuration space, which refers to the coordinate xa of particle n. So this is a divergence. So what this is telling you is that probabilities evolve with velocity v, and there is a flux rho v of probability, and the probabilities evolve in such a way that the total amount of probability is conserved. Not only it is conserved, it is locally conserved. There is a local conservation law which is described by this equation. So what we would like to do next is prove this. The proof is straightforward. It's just algebra. We start from the fact that the probability rho, let's change the notation slightly and call this the probability x at time t is equal to the integral of a transition probability from time t0 to time t of a probability distribution from time t0. So I've just written the same equation we had up here, except that we would like to be able to, we would like to be able to take derivatives with respect to t. Now, unfortunately, as t goes to t0, when these two are very, very close together, this probability distribution is sharply peaked. It only allows short steps. So it's not, it actually takes the form of a delta function as delta t goes to zero, right? As t minus t0 goes to zero. So it is not actually possible to simply just take derivatives with respect to t here. So what we're going to do is we're going to consider exactly the same form of equation, but for a finite step when t is not close to t0. After all, an equation like this was just obtained by marginalizing x0. We can marginalize whether the t is close to t0 or not. So this is an equation for finite differences in time from t to t0. Then we can take derivatives with respect to t. So what we're going to do is we're going to rewrite this equation for as a integral equation for this transition probability. This is a special case of a rho, a special case in which you start from a given t0. Rewrite this equation as px T plus delta T. So what we are rewriting is this equation here, when we start with the equation for rho T, is this object here. So this is equal to, we're going to integrate P z T plus delta T. And here we have z, x z t, and this is p z t x zero, I forgot that part here, plus delta t x zero t zero equals x zero t zero there. So let us review what it is I have done here. Yeah, for the case of a finite step from t0 to t, this would be the equation, except we do not know what this guy is. This is finite. We only know it in when it is infinitesimal, an infinitesimal delta t. So what I'm going to do is rewrite this equation for the evolution of this kernel here. So the kernel we want is the kernel from t0 to t plus delta to t plus delta t. Here we have t plus delta t and t0 to t. So just rewrite in this equation for a special case of this rho. Very good. As I said before, we cannot just take derivatives of these guys here, because t to t plus delta t, this is close to being a delta function of x minus z. If you don't give enough time, you're not going to move. So that's just basically what's going on. You essentially do not make transitions far away from this guy to that. So how do we handle this? The way this is handled is we multiply both sides by a function of x and we integrate. This is called test function. So when we multiply by a function of x, the left hand side is going to look like the integral of what was the left hand side before, x t plus delta t x0 t0 multiplied by a test function, an arbitrary function that's sufficiently smooth that while we can't do Taylor expansions in delta t in this guy because this is too singular, it varies too quickly as a function of x, this function here is supposed to be smooth enough that we can do all sorts of tricks with it. And the right hand side, so what I'm going to do next is I'm going to write this equation, and I'm going to integrate it over dx, multiply by fx and integrate over dx. And so I'm going to do that, but I'm going to write, exchange the orders of integration, and now we're going to do the dx, and it's going to be the transition probability xt plus delta t z at time t multiplied by the fx and then p z t 0 t 0. Very good. Now, while it is true that I can't quite expand or Taylor expand this transition probability for infinitesimal increase in time by delta t, I can definitely expand this guy here. And so I'm going to expand it, Taylor expand. Remember, because this is like a delta function, the z and the x are very close together. So I'm going to Taylor expand about the point z. So the object there in the square brackets is now going to look as follows. Dx, this guy here that looks almost like a delta function, the transition probability. And then here I'm going to do the expansion. Here this is going to be fz plus the derivative of f with respect to z, and then the increment xa minus za plus higher order terms. The idea here is that we want to include terms that are of order delta t only, okay? So this piece here, when I integrate, this is delta x, and I'm integrating with the probability, this is going to be like v delta t. The next term is going to be quadratic, it's going to be delta t squared, that's going to be higher order. So the first piece here, I'm integrating over delta x, over x, and this is fz. So the first piece just gives me the integral of the probability, which is 1, so I have fz plus dfz, dfdza, multiplied by the expected value of the small jump from z to x. So that's going to be va delta t plus terms that are higher order in delta t. Very good. So now we have that. So we just plug it back in. And what we have is, so substitute back. Into these equations here, and what we have is going to be okay. The first term is just this integration here. Well, the brackets. I'm just going to have fz. So let me write it out. Substitute back into the right hand side. And this is going to be dz pz t x0 t0 fz. That's the first term here, plus the second term. The second term is going to be dz. There's going to be df dz a va dt multiplied by pzt x0 t0. We're almost there. What I'm going to do is two things. First, if you look at this equation, the left-hand side includes the probability at time t plus delta t. This equation here, if you forget about the z and just call it x because it's a dummy variable, here we have the same equation but evaluated at t. Here it's t plus delta t, there it's t. When I get this term onto the other side, what I get is dx, the difference between this probability distribution and this one, that's going to be dt p x t x0 t0 multiplied by delta t. Just the difference between these two, it's a first term. The Taylor expansion. There is no problem in taking this derivative because t and t0 are very far apart. And then all of this multiplied by fz, by fx. And on the, what the remaining term on the right-hand side, what I'm going to do is I'm going to integrate it by parts. So when I integrate by parts, I get minus the integral. I'm going to call this z. I'm going to also relabel it x. And then I have the derivative with respect to x a of v a p x t x 0 t 0, the derivatives act on all of this, and then there is a delta t, and there is an f of x. Now, very good, we're done. We can cancel out the delta t's on both sides. And now, this is the trick about test functions. This function here is arbitrary. Since it is arbitrary, it means that in order for this equality between the integrals to be valid for absolutely every choice of f, it must be true that it is not just the integrals that are equal, but also the integrands. So this dt is equal to that. So this gives us a continuity equation for that kernel. Okay, let me write it out explicitly. Since fx is an arbitrary test function, it follows that the integrals must match, the integrands must match. And we obtain this continuity equation for the kernel that we have up here. So what I'm going to do now is next, finally, take the time derivative on the left-hand side, time derivative here, substitute take the time derivative of the equation star And so what we're going to have for the equation star, it's, I'll just review it again. Once again, it's this equation here. Let me write this as equation star. Take the time derivative here, take the time derivative there, and substitute this guy here by the divergence. So we're going to have the time derivative of rho x t is going to be the integral, the time derivative of p x t x 0 t 0 rho x 0 t 0. Substitute this here. And now here we notice that v is a function of x. Here the integration is over xa. So this is a derivative with respect to x. This is a function of x. We can pull them outside. Very good. Va. And then what we have here is dx0 pxt x0 t0 rho x0 t0. And so we notice that what we have here is once again the same equation star. So the conclusion is dt rho is equal to minus derivative of rho a v, which is what we wanted to demonstrate. So it works the same, the integral equation that we have here. Just to review, the integral equation that we have here can be written in differential form. The idea here was to consider a finite jump in time from t0 to t, and the way we solve for this finite time transition probability is we just use the original equation and rewrite it as the equation from t to t plus delta t. So it's exactly the same equation there. And the way we manipulate this, because we cannot just take Taylor expansions of this function here, it's too sharp, we multiply by a test function to smoothen the whole thing, integrate, and then manipulate, do your Taylor expansions, switch the orders of integration, do whatever you need to do until you have the equation of evolution for that kernel, finite time transition probability, and that you use to construct the distribution again. Very good. So this is one form of the differential equation for evolution, the differential form for evolution. But there is another very, very suggestive form that's going to be useful. Another form for the evolution equation. This other form goes like this. I'm just going to rewrite what we have just written down there. I'm going to write the divergence, and I'm going to write rho times the velocity here. What is the velocity? The velocity is given by the equation that we saw looks like the momentum equation in Hamilton-Jacobi theory. This piece here is the velocity Va. So what we're going to do is say, look, the evolution of the probability distribution here is given by rho times some current velocity. The current velocity depends on the drift potential. So the way I'm going to write this, which is very suggestive, is to say, look, we can write this as the functional derivative of some functional of rho and phi, where h is a functional of rho and phi. How do we know that we can do this? So this is the derivative at the point x. I'm going to write this as the derivative of this, whatever this monstrosity here is, with respect to phi. So how do we know that we can actually do this? How do we know that we can replace all of this stuff here by a single derivative? Well, we set this equal to that, and if we can integrate this functional differential equation to find what h is, then we have a proof. We show that we can construct an h tilde because we did. So it's actually easy to do this integration. Don't be fooled by this bunch of derivatives that you have floating around. These are derivatives with respect to x. Rho is a function of x. As far as phi is concerned, rho is a constant. As far as phi is concerned, all of these are just constants. So what we have is a linear functional differential equation for this h. And the solution is actually very simple. It's the following. This object here is a functional of these two fields, and the functional is going to be 1/2 m rho m, the inverse of the mass tensor. Then we have the a phi minus a the b phi minus a b plus a constant of integration, something that is constant with respect to phi, but it needed to be constant with respect to rho. So this is just the f here is a constant of integration. So what we see here is that whatever this h is, it's quadratic in phi's, and then there is all sorts of other stuff that may depend on rho. It is an expected value. This is the integral over rho x of some functions of x. How do we prove that this is true? Well, we substitute here and we see if it works. I mean, this is the ultimate method to solve differential equations, any differential equation. You guess an answer, plug it back in, and if it works, you did it. In this particular case, the equation is linear. There's going to be one constant of integration. That's it. So if this works, it's the general solution. So we plug that back in. And how do we do this? Well, we just do the derivative. If we do the change in h when we take the derivative with respect to phi, let's just do it. There's going to be two of these terms, one when I take delta phi here, another one when I take delta phi there. And so this is going to give me rho m a b. Let me do the second term first. It's going to be the derivative, the derivative b of delta phi. The derivative of the a is zero. So this is what we get. Now, we get another term when we have the a's and the b's exchanged, but this tensor is symmetric. So what we get really from the two differentiations is a factor of 2, which cancels that 1/2. So this is the answer. So now, next, what we do, we integrate this by parts. We integrate this by parts, and so what we have is d rho m a b d a phi minus a d phi x. And here we have that then the differential of h tilde is some integration multiplied by the differential of phi. By definition, with a minus sign, with a minus sign because I integrated the dv by parts. By definition, whatever appears here is the functional derivative of x, and you can see that this object that appears here with A and B exchange is precisely that. So we have that. Now, why is this form very suggestive? Because it tells us that our entropic dynamics has led us to a differential equation for the evolution that coincides with one half of Hamilton's equations. This is a strong suggestion that whatever this phi, capital phi is, it is the momentum that is canonically conjugate to the rho. So you can see that we're starting to get real physics out of all of this. But that is for next time. See you then.